Hello and welcome to These Are the Days of our podcast. I'm Jen.
And I'm Lisa. And today we're celebrating World Friendship Day, which was celebrated on July 30th. Woohoo! So, do you have any friends, Jen?
So rude. OMG. So I thought we were friends, but comments like that mean you're cut. Actually, no, you're not cut.
No. I need you.
No.
I'm just kidding. My abandonment issues are coming out.
You can never be cut. You're stuck with me. So since we met
in... Is Carrot your friend?
Carrot is in my top five friends.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. And Carrot and I have a romantic couple of weeks coming up, just like all of the friend dates. We're going to take the train, maybe go to the seaside. We have so much friendship planned.
Enjoy, because she is a weird friend.
Well, tell me, Lisa, do you have friends?
Yeah, I got a couple, I have to say. Got some friends. It's pretty. I mean, it's funny looking up things about friendships, and it is so hard to make friends as adults.
I know. We don't have anything you need to say about this that hasn't been said before, but it's genuinely so difficult. Like, our most enduring friendships are either from childhood and adolescence or university. And beyond that, I feel like I have all of these passing characters in my life who I worked with or I've lived near or have intersected in some way. And I feel like they're really close friends, but then they kind of vanish into the ether when the circumstances of your life change. And I feel like
does it make them not your friend, or does it just make them like a friendship for that moment in time?
Yes. So I think that that's absolutely true. And that's something that the pandemic, I think, has really brought into focus for me, where it's like some friends are of different definition, I would say. And yeah. I think that everyone's circle like kind of constricted during the pandemic. And there are certain people that really you've possibly even gotten closer to in the pandemic, even with all of the restrictions. And there are some people that have completely dropped off the map. And that doesn't mean that you weren't friends or that you're not still friends, but it's
or just... you couldn't be friends again.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any – I think there's a lot of negative connotations when a friendship ends naturally because of changing of circumstances. But I think friendships can be just like moments in times. Like, you have tiers of friendship or levels of friendship.
Yeah.
Not just like everyone needs to be your best friend all the time.
It's true. It's true. No, I think it's a really valuable point. And I also think it's really important to think about the levels of friendship, because you can have different expectations for different types of friends.
Yeah.
And if you hold everyone to the same standard, you're just going to get really disappointed that they'll just keep letting you down because they're not doing for you what you expect. But it might just be they're at a different level of friendship.
Or just at a different point in their life. Like, some people are wrapped up in like how I must be really difficult to make super good friends if you like just had a child or something. Like, or move to a completely different place and you're on a different time zone. I think it's just life circumstances, personalities, everything.
So according to the research.
Of the internet.
The research. No.
We do real research, guys. Come on.
There is a researcher that talks about this that I read things about.
Excellent.
And so according to this researcher, there are four different levels of friendship, and all of them are important. All of them provide value, but they're just different levels. So level one is an essential friend, and this is your core group of close friends. And this researcher says that the essential friends are your confidants, the people that you would share your deepest values with, and they're very loyal. They stick around no matter what. So I think requiring everyone to be an essential friend is unrealistic. There are only a certain number of essential friends that you have in your life, but those are really important. But also, to bring up some things that your therapists have said. These are spaces that we can learn important relationship skills, because with your essential friends, you actually do need to work through conflict. You can't just go your separate ways. It's right. a space where you can learn about like unconditional love and forgiveness and empathy and conflict management and all sorts of things like that that are actually really hard skills to manage. And it's only really in these like safe spaces of essential friendship that you might be able to work through these skills. So
yeah, I actually would say, I know I was arguing about some friendships end, but I think when you go through a quote-unquote divorce with an essential friend, it's like as devastating or even more devastating than a breakup.
Oh, I 100% agree. And I know that both of us have had some really intense friend breakups that like have struck me to my core and I still think about today. And it, in a way, it kind of makes, I don't know, I think it's harder because it makes me feel like there's something at your core that's inadequate versus in a romantic relationship, you can be like, oh, you're different places in your life. It's a lot easier. There's a lot more resources about breakups. But friendship breakups are devastating.
Yeah, I agree. I've had one and it was – I think there were issues on both sides, but it was it was difficult.
I still have shame over friendship breakups. That has
it's happened. Important to have shame over everything, Jen, and just internalize it.
Channel it into crafts.
Channel it into like think of your most unhealthy behavior. Channel it into that. You know, that's really the solid advice we've got from therapists.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's like, oh, you have shame about this friendship breakup and you feel like you like have some issues at the core of your being. You should definitely go online shopping.
Oh, yeah. Amazon, take all my money.
Or maybe just eat more chocolate. That will fix it. Definitely. We are licensed medical professionals.
Did I eat like, I don't know, 10 tins of quality street chocolate this past year? Yeah. I did.
But
do I regret any of it? No. Okay, back on track.
Circling back to friendship.
Back on track.
The next level is collaborators. And these are the friends that you share an emotional connection at a specific point in time. These relationships require physical proximity and emotional intimacy in order to function. So your context for these relationships is really important. So when your context changes, like you move to a different place or there's like a different job or whatever, you might transition out of these collaborators. But importantly, collaborators often, you can catch up with them in other points in your time because they are the sorts of people that you could have any conversation with and you can go to them if you needed support.
So, correct.
Important to have. So level three are associates. Oh. These titles, I feel like they're not.
Like they're business. Like someone in the business world wrote this as well.
So an associate is someone that shares a common interest. So this could be a hobby, a passion, or you could meet at a happy hour or a book club or potentially a cycling club.
Potentially.
You know, something like that. So they're typically not the people that you would, you know, reveal your deepest and darkest secrets with, but and it's important to have boundaries with these relationships. And so we might spend a lot of time with them, but there aren't a lot of expectations beyond the context of that shared hobby or work or something like that. I think that this is the category of friendship that's been most impacted for me in the pandemic, where you have these people that you spend a huge amount of time with at work or in your regular life hobbies, and then all of a sudden they've disappeared off of the landscape. And it's not that you don't like them or that they don't like you. It's just that they're gone for a while. And
yeah, but they'll come back. Possibly. Yeah,
they might come back. Yeah. And then the final rung of the friendship ladder is the mentors or mentees. And this is just quite an asymmetrical friendship dynamic. So there is uneven power and control. So all of the other friendship levels that we've mentioned have been really symmetrical in terms of power, in terms of deciding when and how often you hang out. In an unequal relationship, there's like generally one person who kind of has a little bit more to say about the dynamics of the relationship and the depth at which that relationship progresses. So this is sometimes like it could be with someone like a manager, for example, but it could be, you know, outside of the workplace. It could just be someone that you have a relationship with, but it's not on equal footing. So those are the four levels. Business speak.
Well, it turns out friendship is good for your health.
What?
I know. It's good for you.
What?
Except for when you convince your friends to do unhealthy things.
Like a juice cleanse?
Like a juice. So it obviously increases your sense of belonging and purpose.
Important.
Important. That can clearly boost your happiness and reduce your levels of stress. And obviously stress is no good for you. High blood pressure, the diabetes, so you're short with your family and your friends, insomnia, etc., etc. It obviously can improve your self-worth, and your friends listen and validate your feelings and, you know, make fun of other people with you. So it's good.
We don't ever do that. We're just genuine, kind, sweet-hearted ladies.
Okay, you know what? If someone doesn't make fun of another person, they're a psychopath. Like, come on. Who doesn't tease other people?
Okay? Yeah.
They're a psychopath. That is our
primary love language.
Exactly. If you literally live your whole life and never say something bad or tease another person, I don't trust you. Moving on. They help you cope with, like, traumas, you know, big life changes. And lastly, which I think is very valid for our friendship, they help you in personal development. Maybe not development to say, like, would I buy a chocolate orange, you buy a chocolate orange, or when you sign up for a marathon, I sign up for a marathon. So, like, sometimes good things, sometimes bad things, but hopefully good things.
Yeah.
We do always encourage each other to tweet ourselves. And that sometimes
is good and sometimes not good.
Exactly.
And sometimes we both sign up for an exercise class and you don't have to go. It's because they wouldn't let me cancel and they let you cancel. And sometimes you put in a ballot for the London Marathon and one person gets it. One person doesn't, and so one person has to run a marathon in a month, and the other person doesn't.
Has to walk on their treadmill desk.
So, yeah. But I actually think
why did you get, like, super into speed walking?
Yeah.
We're both doing the movement of speed walkers because we're so good at it.
Yeah, the visual element really translates well on a podcast.
Yeah.
But I think it's a genuinely good suggestion because – well, I am supposed to be running right now.
Oh.
I am not.
Well, we're going swimming after. Yes. I'll make you swim super fast. And if you don't, I'll splash you.
This is true friendship. These are the sacrifices you're willing to make for me. You're welcome. I appreciate it and dislike it at the same time.
Yeah. It's a good friendship. Mm. It's a good one.
We have a very exciting surprise for you because we have another friend. We have another friend who
has very awesomely decided to come on our podcast. I would like to introduce,
drum roll please,
our number one friend, Tori.
Woohoo! Hey ladies, I'm so excited to be on the pod.
Thank you for joining us all the way from Canada. It's awesome.
Woo!
She home actually does have a Toronto Blue Jays artwork behind her, so it's very Canadian.
Yeah.
So the reason why we have Tori on the podcast is today is International Friendship Day, and she is one of our favorite friends.
Yeah, number one.
I am so honored.
We're really excited.
I mean, she's like dropped down because her daughters are way cuter than her and sassier. Mm-hmm. And this is what I've always wanted in a true friend. So she's now not number one friend, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm number three.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. You accept.
It's pretty good. So I thought we would get started by talking about our origin story a little bit. And I've prepared a special surprise that Lisa doesn't know about. This is the Diamond Heist speech.
Oh my god! Yay! The speech from the wedding?
Yeah. So I'm going to set the scene. This is where it all began. Let me take you back to our spiritual home, to the inception of this beautiful friendship. It's 2005. Peak Harry Potter madness has hit the world, and a bunch of precocious youths decided to buck the normal start to their university careers, heading instead for Hursmonceux Castle in southern England. Woo. This is obviously one of the best decisions young Lisa, young Tori, and young Jen made, as it got all of us stupendous characters together, and we would become fellow troublemakers and adventure partners. And you'd be stuck with us. So,
and you're stuck with us.
Yeah. Lisa, we actually met shortly before the castle as sullen 18-year-olds at orientation. Our mothers hit it off, and like classic toddlers, we eyed each other suspiciously, convinced that there was no way these new friends could be as cool as our high school crews. I don't remember the exact moment that we became friends, but it almost certainly involved sitting on my dorm room floor and drinking Walmart brand alcohol.
Oh my god. I feel like I need to go to Asda right now and just like pick up some disgusting vodka for this weekend.
Oh, 100%. I want the black currant flavored vodka that came in the bottle that looked like a conditioner bottle. That's really I'm feeling. I'm sure that needs to happen. So just before we continue, Lisa and I and one of our other friends from the castle are heading back to the castle this weekend. We've rented dorm rooms and we're gonna stay at the castle.
I am so jealous, guys.
I know. And apparently we're the only ones there. There's no one else staying. And I was like, oh, we're gonna run amok. We need to get this Asda brand vodka and just run amok in the dorm rooms. Like, oh, it's like 2005.
Yes, yeah. You have to go to Asda first, 100%.
But Lisa and I hit it off at the castle, so we didn't have our mother's matchmaking for us, as she would just be shrieking down the corridor between our rooms with joyous abandon. Our relationship, though, really received some firm grounding in the first week, where she makes her first appearance in my journal, which I've recorded for posterity. It says that we were walking to a nearby village to go to the pub. Lisa and I had made an impractical decision to wear heels, you know, to impress all the British guys.
Because I'm so short.
Yeah. And by the end of the evening, we regretted our decision. So on the walk back, Lisa decided to take off her shoes and proceeded to step in poop, which obviously was an important memory for me to log in my journal. And since that time, we have been friends and we make fun of each other and talk a lot about poop. So,
well, one time Tori peed on my foot. So, yes. In Cinque Terre in Italy. And I was mad. I was mad. I mean, it was a very steep hill, but I was mad.
It was a roll downhill situation. It wasn't intentional.
It wasn't an intentional pee. It's true. It's true.
It's a gravity
induced.
Yes.
It's surprising that we all made it out of the Hursmonceux Castle year alive. And we have so many stories that we are not allowed to share on a podcast.
Absolutely not.
No, God, no.
maybe you could tell us why you became friends with us, because that's like, I became friends with you because of like walking into poop. So
so here's the thing, I have a horrible memory. I don't even remember that speech, and that was only 4 years ago. So it was like listening to new. I was like, listen, when we're all really old and Tori's children are taking care of us, 100% I'm the one with Alzheimer's. So not a great memory, but I did thoroughly enjoy going to the castle with both of you. Yeah. And I just remember, I do remember Tori and Megan's room at the end of the hall. And I used to come run down the hall and Tori would make her bed like a crazy person. And I would wrinkle her sheets. I just walk in and then I just like fall right back on the bed and just go wrinkle, 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 wrinkle.
Yeah.
And then do it. Just, and then there were all the sheeps in the field, and I named the black sheep Tori, and you were so mad. You were like actually offended by that one.
Tori, nothing made me as angry as when you and I think Davey ate my advent calendar chocolates starting about halfway through the month, so I didn't realize it until I was really committed to that particular calendar. And I think he left mocking notes in their place.
Unforgivable. That is, I can't believe you're still friends, to be honest, after that sort of display of behavior.
That is honestly one of my favorite things ever. Because I remember writing the little notes and they were mean. And I was like, let's put those mean thoughts. I was like, oh yeah, let's be like really mean.
Yeah. Yeah. Those in. Oh, Jen, do you remember? Do you remember the drama in our hallway at the castle? Because Lisa was renowned, infamous is maybe a better way to put it, for her shriek as she ran down the hall and slammed doors as she was visiting the friends.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes, that was exactly what I was referencing. It was a little bit more gently worded in the official Diamond High speech, but yeah, the shrieking eels of Lisa Henry running down the hall is a sound that still reverberates in my core.
Yes,
and just it always started and ended with a door slam. And
always.
The deadbolt hitting the metal because we never actually closed the doors.
You never actually closed the door. Yeah. Yeah. That is a really, that's a good point. I will say, I know it all started at the castle and that's very exciting, but I was like, there's been some other major points of our friendship.
Which we can get to in our next leg where Tori's going to take the lead because then we all move to Kingston and continue our adventures.
Yes.
That's true.
After the castle, when we settled into university life at Queens and Kingston, Lisa became more mature.
Mature is what we say. Mature.
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 That's when we started calling her Lady Lisa. Most Sundays were spent devoted to the Bible. It was the Sex and the City Bible, but we were very devout. And she was really committed to her very practical degree in art history.
Which, okay, when- listen. That's it. First interruption. Listen. Yeah. Go to a museum with me. Who knows all the things? Who looks like the fanciest person in the museum now? Okay. I live in London. I'll go to the National Gallery and then I'll impress everyone with my facts.
Okay? Ooh, ooh, ooh. Facts about art.
Yeah. Okay.
And then at the end of university, in celebration of our newfound maturity, we skipped our graduation and went to Thailand. Us and Sid.
It was fun. It was very fun.
Yeah.
I would say that the university years in Kingston, Tori and Lisa lived at the iconic house. And that was where all of the coolest and best parties were. And so I think they were the beating heart of the much broader friend group. And there were a lot of characters that came to and fro out of Albert Street that just really add so much color to our lives.
Yeah.
I would say those are like the major eras of like our budding friendship. And then we kind of scattered a bit. Lisa went to Korea. I did some things. You did something.
Well, Tori was an actual Ottawa.
Yeah, no. So I lived in Toronto for the first year after graduation. And then I was in the Ottawa Valley for 2 years in Pembroke. And then mm-hmm. I was in Ottawa for
I forgot 4 years. You lived in Pembroke.
Yes. So then we became adults and Tori,
we scattered,
but we came back for an epic Tori and Mikey wedding.
Yes. In 2014, everyone came to Ottawa.
Everyone's favorite place came to Ottawa, and there were 7 people in my hotel room. That's how many people it was. Like the 282 Albert Street of Tori's wedding. I just remember forcing the DJ to play mine and Tori's song, Easy Silence by the Dixie Chicks. Tori and I are singing and dancing, and Megan is just next to us, just going,
singing along. She didn't know any words.
If we were at karaoke, what song would we be singing?
Interesting. So Easy Silence by the Dixie Chicks is our song, but it's also very slow and kind of sad. Yeah. So if we're at fun karaoke.
I mean, I think it's a Dixie Chicks song because I hate country music, but Tori loves country music. Mm. And so we meet in the middle only at the Dixie Chicks.
Yeah. Mm. So it could be Not Ready to Make Nice.
Or just the Chicks now.
Yeah, not the Dixie Chicks anymore. Not Ready to Make Nice would be good, but if we're looking to make that'd it more a of a one. Party and more representative of our whole friend group, I think it could be Push the Button.
I knew you were going to say that.
Or Don'tcha by the Pussycat Dolls. That was also big that year.
Oh, that was a big one. I think it would be Push the Button.
Yeah, because there's a lot of good
so many dance button moves.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a lot of good button moves in between the singing.
That would have to be it.
That's true.
I was going to say, because Lisa and I, our song is You and I, which is also like really romantic and slow.
Pink and Dallas Green one.
Okay, yeah.
You and me, we've got two minds, I think as one, and our hearts march to the same
beat. So it's maybe a little bit too sweet and sentimental for a karaoke night, but
if we're singing at karaoke, we are not sober, so it's gonna be it's not gonna be a sweet and sentimental song.
I think the best thing for a throwback would be Disney karaoke. Yeah. For the Disney nights that we used to have at 282 Albert, where we like listed. Do you remember Kelsey made the list of the 10 hottest inanimate objects in Disney movies? And it was like the magic carpet, number 1, and then all the way to number 10, which was Stevie Eiserman. Yes. I was like, how did he make it on the how is he on the list or in Disney? But Stevie Eiserman, 10 hottest inanimate objects.
Yeah, we found those lists the next morning. I remember Abu's hat. Yeah. Was on there.
Oh yeah, it was definitely on there. That's a good hot one. It's a good one.
Yeah, so that's a good one. So I'm gonna just like move on. One of Tori and my major memories is when we went to the T-Swift concert.
Oh yeah,
it was amazing. Yeah.
1989.
And so that was in T-Swift's like major, like it was the apex of her girl gang phase. So I was wanting us to think, if we were to add some celebs to our girl gang, who do you think you would want to include in the fold?
Oh, I know who Tori would include instantly.
Tay-Tay, obviously.
Oh, I was going to say Britney Spears.
Oh, I would way prefer to have Tay-Tay in our squad. Like poach her from
Tay-Tay Taylor Swift?
We would poach her from her own squad.
Yeah.
And include her in ours. Yeah. Yeah.
I actually have seen Taylor Swift. I got a client gave me tickets once, and so I got to go.
Yes. You went to the 1989 tour as well and like did not make a big were just like very nonchalant about it. And this was like a major moment for Tori and I.
Oh yeah, we took the day off, whole days off work.
Yeah, oh my
it
God.
Was an experience.
Fine, I'll accept Taylor Swift, but like only because like I actually like her, you know, fighting for like a women's rights and et cetera, et cetera. But I feel like if anything, we should have Britney Spears.
I mean, we could help free her.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have to. I mean, I feel like we could free her, you know? Like, and she could be our friend.
The person that I've always thought would be really fun to hang out with and would really jive with our friend, like, energy would be Robin. And I stand by that. I think that she would be just so much fun. And when I was in Stockholm, I know the neighborhood she lives in. So I'd just be walking around being like, is Robin around? Can she be my friend? Which apparently is not the way you make friends, but.
No, it's so weird.
You don't think that's ever so happened? Because people, you know, you think about, oh, if this celebrity saw me and interacted with me, they'd think I was awesome and be my friend. Do you think that's ever happened? Like a famous person encounters a fan, thinks they're awesome, and they become friends.
Yeah, I actually think it does happen. Maybe not with the super famous. I mean, like Jen couldn't make friends with celebrities, but I don't really think I could. Oh, you probably couldn't either. So we're definitely not doing it. Well, so we can't, but some people can if they're cooler than us.
The only exception to this is that I'm really, really bad at recognizing people. And I have been to a party with a band, like in the UK, I'm even more hopeless because I don't know any of the celebs here. And so I have been to a party with some like B-list celebs and didn't know any of them and was like really chill about hanging out with them because I had no idea who they were. So my next question, Tori, you win $10 million. Where are you taking us on vacation?
Wow. Okay, first of all, I don't even think $10 million is that much.
Oh, it's definitely enough for me to treat you guys to like an awesome girls trip.
Like, I think you need to give her $20 million.
I'm going to say... I'm gonna say $10 million. I would take you on a girls' trip. I'm just saying that.
Okay, fine.
If you had $10 million and you didn't take me on a girls' trip somewhere, I would be mad. But also, I can't not be friends with you. So,
okay. I have an answer. So, if it were to happen soon, I'd probably do New York City because I can't be away from the babies for that long.
Okay, can we just pretend that you don't exist just for
then
like a hot
Thailand,
second?
100%.
Okay.
But what if you brought the babies and we just, you know, we can increase it by another $5 million and they'd have like a little
hired help.
And we just like hire people to take care of the children and then we can do Thailand.
Yeah. Let's do Thailand. Yeah. I know not everyone was on our trip to Thailand, but we would get everyone there, create new memories with a whole broader friend
group.
That's
true.
And it would be amazing.
That's true.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be really good. I would pick, I don't know. I feel like we could go somewhere in like Africa. Ooh. Like I'd like to do like a Namibia, like safari kind of thing, mostly because I want us to be like dangerous situation and see how everyone reacts. We're like, Jen instantly would be sacrificed to the lions. Like she'd just like give up. Just like fall over.
Wait, is she sacrificing herself or are we sacrificing her to the lion?
It's actually a little bit of both. But yeah, I think we could do like safari in Namibia. That would be like where I would take everyone.
That's a great group activity. That's a good call.
Yeah. And then like you can go to like, we'll go to the coast and go to the beaches or whatever. And then also it'd be like cheaper than Thailand, I think. So
yeah, but we have our lottery winning.
So I don't have to spend all.
I never said
well,
I
don't want to spend my 10 million.
You know, put you up somewhere nice.
You are getting to get this shack. Yeah. Oh, we'll still get dysentery. Yeah.
Perfect.
No matter what.
That's important. I feel like, well, since our friendship is based on poo, I feel like it needs to be dysentery and like food poisoning has to be involved in any major trip.
Where would you take us, Jen?
So I was thinking I really have really liking the island vibes for a girl trip, and I would go like Solomon Islands or something like that. Just looks really beautiful and lovely.
And it'd also be like really cool, like worth its money.
Yeah.
Like the Maldives or the Solomon Islands or something.
So
that's true.
I think that would be a great trip. And then we just get to swim with the turtles. And I'm just assuming there's going to be, for me, because I am not a married lady, there's just going to be some like very attractive man emerging from the ocean. And that will be one of my activities of the girls trip.
Yeah.
So that's.
I'm assuming yes.
Realistic. Well, now because you guys are both like happily married ladies, you can be my ultimate wing people on this beautiful tropical island.
Listen, I am really good at being your wing person.
Okay, I have a few other questions that I'm curious about. Do you know how to make friendship bracelets?
Not anymore.
No. Not anymore, no.
I recently made them during the pandemic because I was so bored, and I mailed them to my niece, so... I could make you friendship bracelets, but I probably won't.
And I won't. I wouldn't wear yours.
Oh, diss. Yeah. Wouldn't wear your friendship bracelet.
You ever owned one of those half heart metal necklaces that were popular in the 90s that were like BFFs?
Yes, but do you know Tori made me a necklace of her holding a little dog? It's just a little charm. I feel like it has to be the cover art for this episode.
Yeah.
It's just like a little Tori holding a little dog.
That's amazing. And
I still have it.
And yes, please take a picture of it.
Yeah.
I totally forgot about that. That's hilarious.
Yeah, it was like my birthday present one year. Just a picture of Tori holding a little dog.
It's beautiful.
Oh, wow.
And, it's so beautiful.
And yes, I did own one of those half heart things, at least one, if not several, back in elementary
school.
Can
you remember the name of the people you had the other heart with? Or are they not your best friends anymore?
Not my best friends anymore, but yes, I remember some of the names of people.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. That's good.
Okay, so my final friendship-based question is, okay, if we were to create a retirement community for us to live back together, what
Which
would be
we will.
One of luxury amenity that you would insist on?
I mean, don't retirement communities already have like servants for anyways? So well, they do. That's what you're paying for. Like my grandma's was like so good, and they like fed her all the time, and they always had activities, and I was like, I'll live here, this is great. So they're kind of like servants.
I mean
you pay them
staff.
Nah.
I feel like I would want a weekly happy hour. Yes.
No, I... Yeah.
Weekly happy hour.
I mean, but that's pretty standard, I'd felt.
It's not luxury? It
well,
feels
no,
like a luxury.
No, I don't feel like that's luxury.
I think that the thing is that like, when fair. We're selecting our retirement community, we just need to know, like, what are the...
Oh, you're looking...
Yeah, what are the non-negotiables? We definitely need to have, like, a pretty rip-roaring happy hour. Absolutely.
We need to have slaves. Got it. Okay.
Yeah, booze-related... So... activities centered around the consumption of alcohol.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Oh, yeah. Like when we're like 80, it'll just be like beer pong and flip cup. And we'll be like, Tori and I will be like, one time we won a beer tournament. And then try to flip things.
Exactly. Yeah. You have to stay young mentally. And that's how you stay young physically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Then I'm going to revise mine to be like, oh, you know, I don't know what they're called, but because they have so many different names in the UK and Canada. But you know where you get like the like ice cream and then you have all the toppings you can put on top? I think it's called Menchie's is what the one in Canada is called. I want that every single day. I want that as my dessert every day. And I want all the toppings. We're not skimping on toppings. We're getting all the toppings.
YOLO.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I want.
That's a really good one.
That's obviously mine's food related because look at me.
When I was thinking about this, I was thinking like I wanted to have like a spa environment, just like a really nice pool. And then I really want a sauna because I'm obviously Swedish and just want to live a Scandinavian life. So I want there to be like a nice sauna and a beautiful pool. And
yeah,
I'd be. And you know what? I wouldn't be mad if we brought all of these together and someone that we pay brings me a drink poolside and
we have to pay them.
Well, yeah, we're not
no slaves.
We're not having slaves, Lisa.
That's unfortunate. What are children for? What are Tori's children
for?
Well,
they can go get us our frozen yogurt with all of the toppings. So,
yeah, well, I'm not paying them for that. It better be free every night.
Okay.
We usually finish it with like a rapid fire. So I'm just going to pick some of these and you just have to say your first thought. Okay.
Okay.
Tea or coffee?
Coffee.
Summer or winter?
Summer.
What's worse, laundry or dishes?
Dishes.
Love or money?
Love.
Ugh. I knew you would say that. You'd never get any 10 million. Okay, extra finger or extra toe?
Oh, finger.
Yeah, that's a little weird.
I hate magic. Both.
Yeah. Magic carpet or personal robot?
Magic carpet.
Festival or concert?
Concert.
Britney or Beyonce?
Beyonce.
Backstreet Boys or NSYNC?
Backstreet.
Good answer. Choker necklace or mood ring?
Mood ring.
Be a wizard or be a ninja?
Wizard. Come on.
Me too. I met 100%.
Be invisible or being able to fly?
Fly.
Gryffindor or Ravenclaw?
Gryffindor.
Yeah. Jen's a Ravenclaw, so.
I don't have anyone on Ravenclaw team. Everyone we've asked yeah. so far has been Gryffindor.
I have a lot of like sports-based ones because this was obviously when Mark was on the podcast.
Okay.
Ron Weasley. And it was like, if you weren't a rower, Tori, okay, what sport would you be pro at?
Soccer.
Not inner tube water polo, because we did play that.
Very well. No. With our tiny short arms that could hardly reach the water.
Yeah. We were the shortest people on our team. It was you. So Tori, Jen, and Brimmy, Brimmy is the shortest out of the three of you, and you guys are both so short. And I was like, it was only me and my long arms able to like keep us afloat and not like just constantly lose.
We literally could not move.
We did just constantly lose, which was amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, I guess you'd be a soccer player. That's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, that's football for our like four British listeners.
So I think we should thank you for being our guest.
Our favorite friend to be a guest on our pod.
I'm so honored, you guys. When you asked me, I didn't realize I was your favorite friend. So I feel so privileged. You guys are my favorite friends.
That's yay! So good. There are a bunch of exciting and excellent ways that you can celebrate your friendships with some of the other days that are today. And
go
by today,
on.
I mean the 30th of July.
Go
so
on.
So the 30th of July is also Cheesecake Day.
Oh, Lisa. You could go to the Cheesecake Factory with your friends.
Peak friend romance. It's also National Chili Dog Day.
Oh, you could have a chili dog and then a cheesecake, or cheesecake then chili dog. Dessert
and
before dinner.
If your father-in-law happens to be your friend, you can celebrate National Father-in-Law Day and Friendship Day.
I like my father-in-law. He's a very nice man.
Yeah, he is a very nice man.
Yeah. Okay.
And then it's also Supportive Public Education Day, which I don't know. That seems illogical to me because we're in the middle of the summer. This is the last time anyone wants to be thinking about public education. Like, you have the rest of the year. So I'm scratching that off of the list.
It's cut.
But there's one day for the 31st of July that, Lisa, you should know about. It's someone's birthday.
Oh, Harry Potter's birthday.
Yeah.
Okay.
What other birthdays do we have?
So some other famous birthdays. July 31st is J.K. Rowling's birthday. Hence why she had.
Coincidence?
Probably not. I think not, Jen. But on July 30th, we have Emily Bronte, of the very famous Bronte sisters.
One of the more famous Bronte sisters.
Yeah, I'd say she's like second.
She's second most famous. And then like, is it there a Sarah?
There's Anne and Charlotte.
Yep. Anne is like not very famous.
Henry Moore, who's a very famous sculptor. You probably have seen his work at the AGO in Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's got some nice sculpting. British man, but moved to North America. And then problematic man, Henry Ford. Yeah. Just a little problematic. I mean, invented the assembly line and like sort of car. Not fully. He invented it. But also super anti-Semite. So lots of problematic people in history.
Mm-hmm.
He's one of them.
It's a mixed bag. Yeah. From Harry Potter to Henry Ford.
Yeah, even J.K. Rowling, problematic.
Yeah.
Why? Why? Just be a good person.
Everybody just like everybody else. And...
yeah, just be a good person. My God, it's not that hard. Like, we do it every day, minus making fun of people.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess I just, everyone's problematic at some point.
Yeah. Okay, well, I think that's all we have to say on friendship. Thanks for mostly being my friend all of the time.
All the time. Yay.
Goodbye.
Bye.
These are excellent the work. Days, my friends, the hours and the sends. Let's sing and dance and make a bunch of noise. So let the fun ensue and learn a thing or two. These are the days.